Yes, so as Ferran said, I'm presenting a paper that I'm co-authoring with Sunyak Skarning, also from Aarhus University. It's on candidate selection and intra-party violence, and I should mention that this is a very, very first draft, so all types of comments are really very welcome and appreciated. Our starting point for this, which is actually to become a special issue, was, as you see, I put up a picture here of from Zimbabwe of soldiers and police and posters from the opposition party, the Movement for Democratic Change. And I've started out with this because everyone, pretty much everyone, knows the horror stories of electoral violence committed by Mugabe's ZANU-PF party against the opposition throughout the past 10 years or so. So in recent years, this there has been a literature on elections and one on conflict, and they've seemed to have met and developed this new literature on electoral violence that's really expanded over the past 5 years. But it just struck us how everyone seems to be very concerned with inter-party violence. Very few people discuss intra-party violence. So this this picture really comes from an article on how the opposition party in Zimbabwe, the Movement for Democratic Change, have struggled with internal violence in the party. So during the primaries, even up to the 2013 elections, which was in the aftermath of an extremely violent 2008 election where this party had been attacked by the ruling government. They suffered lots of attacks between party members during the primaries when they were to decide on who should run as candidates in various districts. So our point here is to say that really intra-party violence is quite widespread. It's not only in authoritarian regimes as Zimbabwe, we also see it occurring in Kenya, in Nigeria, even in Ghana, which is considered a developed democracy. then I brought along another picture, which is from the ongoing humanitarian crisis in South Sudan, where at least 10,000 people have been killed since 2013, and there's almost 2.5 million people who've been displaced by now. And this crisis actually started out as a dispute between two factions of the ruling SPLM party, the party that took power after South Sudan gained independence. So the president and the vice president were disagreeing over a lot of different things, including how to appoint candidates, particularly for the presidential election. So this is to say that not only is intra-party violence widespread, it can also be very detrimental. But also we found that intra-party violence, although we have this huge and blossoming literature on electoral violence, there is nothing really systematically done cross-nationally on intra-party violence. So it's commonly mentioned in case studies because it is quite prevalent, but it doesn't seem to have been studied very systematically. So that's our starting point for this special issue. So we're starting out with two research questions. One that I'm not sure will really be able to answer within the framework we set out is, how common is intra-party violence during processes of candidate selection in particular? And the second one, which is our focus, is what are the causes of intra-party violence? Because we're not sure that the dynamics are necessarily always the same as for inter-party violence occurring during the national election campaign. The format of the special issue is first an introductory article, and that's the one that I've distributed here and will be presenting today, where we both try to point out why this is an important issue. We also set out a theoretical framework for understanding the causes of intra-party violence, and we try to look at existing data and see if there's actually anything out there that can tell us about the prevalence of intra-party violence and not just electoral violence per se. After that, there will be a range of case studies, and we've chosen to focus on Africa simply to try and constrain the focus a little bit. So there's lots of variation on pretty much everything of interest to us within Africa. And the idea is that these case studies should take our theoretical framework as a starting point, But then should, of course, also allow us to, in the end, amend this theoretical framework. So hopefully we'll learn a lot from these case studies that can both give us an idea of where and when, but also why intra-party violence occurs when the major parties are selecting candidates. So we have quite a few contributors on board, but we still have room for more. Most of them are experts on electoral violence and democratization, and they're also country experts, and most of them have also teamed up with someone from the case in which they do their fieldwork. And finally, we'll have a conclusion that then evaluates the theoretical framework and the findings from the cases, so that we'll be able to say whether this framework actually holds when it meets the empirical cases, and what lessons we've learned, what research questions we should be posting about intra-party violence from now on, and hopefully also try to interrogate the question of how to prevent intra-party violence in the future. Because intra-party violence is often, it's an internal party dynamic, so the ways to mitigate it might be quite different from when trying to prevent violence surrounding the national election day. So it might have more to do with regulating intra-party procedures, which I'll also be discussing more in the theoretical setup. So that's the idea, but it's still very open. Briefly on the concept, so with intra-party violence in relation to candidate selection, we try to define it with a starting point in how you usually define electoral violence. So we're thinking about acts or threats of physical harm against persons or property that takes place during a candidate selection process and has the purpose to affect that process. So it should be aimed at changing the outcome of that process, or who will be able to or interested in running, and so on. And with candidate selection, we're thinking about the processes by which political parties choose who will be their candidates for a particular election. It could be legislative, it could be executive. And we've tried to look at how these procedures vary, and I have to say this is really not my topic of research. This is very new to me. So Pippa has also already pointed out a number of studies that we haven't included that we will be looking at in the near future. But some of the dimensions, and these weren't all in the paper, I apologize for that, but some of the dimensions we'll be looking at is selection criteria. So maybe you have to, there are nationality criteria, there are sometimes age criteria for running as a candidate. Who's the electorate? So who are involved in nominating candidates? How centralized is it? Is it really just the top leadership? Is it by voting, which it will usually be a regular primary when you have a large electorate, or is it by appointment? And finally, how institutionalized are the procedures for picking candidates? So is it very rule-based, or is it informal and patronage-based? And then we are thinking about having two master's students mapping differences in candidate selection procedures in the major parties in African countries. But we're still looking into whether there is actually some work out there. It's a little bit hard to figure out because for some reason, a lot of the work that's done on intra-party democracy and candidate selection procedures in Africa is done by not necessarily researchers, but often by organizations. So we're still trying to map out what's already out there. Then we've always also been looking into whether we can actually find something about the prevalence of intra-party violence. And it doesn't seem like the existing data on violence can really tell us whether violence that occurred prior to election day was related to the election campaign, the national election campaign, or to procedures within the party. So we have very scarce data on who were the perpetrators and who were the victims. So we might know that it was the government that was the perpetrator, but was that then directed towards potential enemies within the ruling front, within the ruling party, or was it against the opposition or voters? We don't really know. So we have two data sets primarily that record incidents of violence in general. We also have at least three data sets who record whether a certain election was violent. So NELDA, and I wrote the IPE, but I of course meant the PEI, and then the VDEM data. And finally, we have data sets that focus specifically, or at least distinguish between electoral violence and other types of violence, so that we can connect the violent episodes to the election campaign, not just because it temporarily fell during the election campaign, but because someone has coded it as an instance of electoral violence. But it still doesn't seem like we can really say whether that was then related to the overall election campaign or the candidate's election process. So in the paper, I also look into whether violence tends to occur before elections, which could indicate that a lot of it is actually intra-party violence. And it does seem to do so, but I don't really have information on whether prior to elections, violence that occurs prior to election, if that's immediately prior to, or maybe 3 or 4 months prior. And then you also need information on when the various parties actually decided on who should be candidate. In some parties where it's very institutionalized, it might be at a certain point in time, but in parties where it's very informal, it might have been decided 2 years in advance. So it's quite hard to figure out how to collect more general cross-national data on this. But that's one of the issues we'll be considering, of whether this is worth doing as well. But because there is very little data right now that can help us do that, we decided on this more case study based and also semi-explorative approach, where we'll come up with a theoretical framework and then see what selected cases from Africa can tell us. The theoretical framework, which then aims to explore the causes of intra-party violence during candidate selection processes, is not very well developed yet, but this is sort of a first sketch. And our starting point was that there has to be some factors on the individual level who causes people to turn to violence. So this might be a certain candidate who decides to use violence to win the nomination for her party. It could be supporters who turn to violence to support their candidate or to protest because their candidate wasn't elected. Or it could be people who are hired by a candidate to carry out violence. And regardless, we will be looking at the incentives to carry out violence. So what are the potential gains compared to the expected costs? And also the opportunities. So can you actually get away with the using violence to win nomination? But obviously these individual level factors will be determined by the environment. So at the institutional level, there are quite a few factors that could be expected to affect whether individuals will turn to violence. And the ones we've picked out so far is the party system, particularly whether we're talking about a dominant party system. Because if you imagine a dominant party system like Uganda, where the ruling party is almost certain, at least in certain districts, that they will win, then the stakes aren't very high in the actual national election. What's interesting is what member of the ruling party will be allowed to run in that district, where they're certain they're going to win. So that means that the stakes of committing violence during the intra-party procedures of nominating candidates are actually higher. So in dominant party systems, violence may actually be pushed from the national election day to the candidate selection procedures. We also looked into electoral systems, because that's really common in the literature on electoral violence to argue that, well, in majoritarian winner-takes-all systems, more is at stakes, so the incentives to use violence might be higher. And I guess you could also argue that, well, it will make a difference whether you're looking for a candidate to run in winner-takes-all district, or if you're looking for several candidates who will all be competing on a PR list. Also, a thing such as the power vested in the position. So we would think that nomination for executive level candidates would be, you would have higher incentives to carry out violence because there's more at stakes. more power vested in the position you could win in the end. Then we've been discussing a factor that I think is quite important, which is the capacity and the impartiality of the state. So if you know that there is a functioning state, that you have the rule of law, then the potential costs of turning to violence are obviously much higher than if you don't expect to be prosecuted. Also, whether the police and military forces are partisan can also change people's decisions of whether to engage in violence. The competitiveness of, and this is a factor that could vary not only on the country level but also on the district level. So if the election is highly competitive, then the individual candidate should be more motivated to use violence to win, because it might only take a few votes that could be persuaded by using violence to change the results. And finally, and perhaps most importantly, the candidate selection procedures within the parties. And this is a factor that's different from the explanations you usually see for electoral violence. So when you think electoral violence, you think about electoral governance, the electoral management bodies. But here it's really about how the parties and not the state regulate procedures. So if candidate selection procedures are highly institutionalized, grievances might be lower, might be, when we haven't really theorized this so thoroughly yet, but you could expect that if you have a highly institutionalized setting, if you have a very decentralized setting where a lot of people have a say, then you might see less violence during candidate selection procedures. On the other hand, you could also think that in a highly centralized system where there's no debate over who will run, you might actually put a lid on violence. So as the debate never occurs, you might also see less violence. So there are a lot of things here we have to think about, but I think it's quite important how these intra-party procedures affect the likelihood that violence will occur during the primaries. And this also means that not only will the likelihood of violence vary across provinces and across districts, it will also vary between the major parties. So for instance, in Ghana, you see quite different propensities to violence within the two different the two major parties. And then also, there are of course some structural factors, and we haven't found that many. But the interesting thing is that there are structural factors that will affect both the likelihood of these institutional capacities being present, and also directly affect individuals' incentives to carry out violence. So for instance, in a post-conflict environment, well, first of all, that will probably affect directly the likelihood of violence. If you have a post-conflict environment such as South Sudan, you will have lots of young men with weapons easily available and no stable source of income who will likely be willing to engage in violence for small amounts of money. So that will actually increase the opportunities to use violence. On the other hand, a post-conflict state is also highly unlikely to have stable candidate selection procedures, to have an impartial and well-functioning state. It's much more likely to have a partisan police force or military, as they will likely have sided with the party that won and is now governing. So there are lots of things, there are lots of dynamics in post-conflict states that will both affect the directly the likelihood of violence, but also affect it indirectly. And a thing such as natural resources really also affects how much is at stake. So if you, by becoming governor of a region or winning the executive, will also control natural resources, you might control huge patronage-based networks. So there's a lot of power at stake in some, at least, resource-rich countries. So that could also heighten the stakes and thus make violence more likely. Control over natural resources could also make it easier for candidates to buy people who are willing to commit violence. And finally, we also have neo-patrimonialism on there, and I'm a little unsure whether that should actually be a separate factor, because it's such a fluffy concept, might be a bit of a hard expression, but it's it plays in with a lot of the other things, but I still put it up there because I do think it really matters how reliant rulers are on patronizing networks and so on. So right now, this unfortunately has the character of a really long list of potential causes, but I think that's also a feature of this model we set up. So we really want these various cases to evaluate this framework, and it might be in South Sudan that the causes of intra-party violence are completely different to those in Ghana, but it's still interesting to try to compare them, and that's why we made sort of a broader framework. But of course, all comments are very welcome. There are probably also as many factors that we've missed, but I'm sure all the people who are doing the case studies will also be telling us that in a little while. So these are the cases that we've chosen so far. And Egypt is right now a little uncertain because some personal circumstances for the person who was supposed to do the Egypt study. And then Ghana is up there because I really like to include Ghana, because I think it would be interesting to have a more democratic and more stable system. But as you see, we tried to pick cases that vary in terms of some of the explanatory causes we picked out, which is hard because there are so many of them. But again, this will be a more explorative character. And then there are some things that I haven't filled out because it really depends on which elections or districts that the people who do the case studies will choose to focus on. And also, some of them I haven't filled out because I don't know, to be completely honest. But the idea is that we have a case like South Sudan, which might be quite an extreme post-conflict case. But I still think it would be really interesting to see whether some of the causes of intra-party violence in South Sudan that have spiraled completely out of hand are actually similar to the ones we see in Ghana. And hopefully we'll never see things in Ghana spiral out of hand to quite the same degree. But I still think really that at the stage we're at right now, where there's pretty much nothing out there on intra-party violence, it would be really interesting to have this broader framework and a great variation of cases. One of the things I've had a hard time with is that I think because electoral systems are so commonly argued to affect electoral dynamics, obviously, then it would be nice to have variation on that factor, but there are very few proportional representation systems in Africa. So we thought about South Africa, but then that's a country that has a completely different way of choosing candidates for the ruling party, so it's very, very centralized and by appointment, by Congress. So it's, in that way, it seemed to be a little too different than other factors. But I'd like to have your input on that as well. I copy-pasted the conclusion from the paper. It's obviously not there yet. But that's just because we're at the very beginning of the process. But in terms of comments, we also haven't decided where this special issue should head to yet. So we thought about the various conflict journals, but we have a conflict researcher on board who says this is too much political science to go into major conflict journals because of the focus on parties. We thought about democratization. We also thought about electoral studies because they seem to be opening up a bit as to what they consider to be within their theme, but I don't know if that's realistic, so input on that is very welcome as well. So yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Merete.